So the hatred against the Métis was just everywhere. And so there's no surprise to me, certainly, or anybody who's a student of history or really wants to look at things carefully, why the Métis in Ontario went underground, virtually. Why there was no presence until gradually in the late 60s people started coming forward. They were in hiding. They were in fear. And I remember clearly in Sault Ste. Marie, we had a meeting one night. We put out a call for people to come and meet us. And this one guy came up to me and he said, well, I'm really glad that you're having this at night and it's dark because it was in the winter. He said, because if anybody from the mill saw me come here and knew that I was Métis, that would be either be the end of my job, but I for certain never get another promotion. That would be the end of it if they found out I was Métis. That was how entrenched racism against the Métis people is in Ontario.
You know, if we look back, you know, why I guess things all fell into place and it was the right time for MNO, is that Métis people in Ontario never had a specific voice. And Métis issues were not being addressed. You know, there wasn't the real consciousness and Métis people weren't being identified in the communities. There was just a lack of knowledge generally about Métis people, and certainly our issues weren't addressed. And it was time for the Métis to have our own voice in Ontario. It's focused specifically on Métis issues and Métis government.
I was at a powwow. It will be 20 years this month, I believe. It was about the 25th of May. And I was leaving the powwow, and I saw this booth, and I saw a blue and white flag. I went up to the young girl that was working the booth and I said, what is this all about? And she started telling me her father was starting Métis Nation of Ontario and told me about it. I said, that's me, I'm Métis. So then she said, well, my father's opening an office and it's in our home on Holland Avenue. So the next day I go and knock on his door and I introduced myself and I said, I'd like to come to work for you. And he said, oh, well, I don't have any money to hire these days. And I said, no, as a volunteer. Oh, well, he welcomed me with open arms. And so I went up there in his attic. We worked out of his attic, hot as the dickens. We didn't even have money to buy file cabinets. We filed in orange boxes.
The beginning of 93, that I received a letter from a fella named Tony Belcourt. I had never heard of him, I didn't know who he was, and it was a letter informing me and other people that they were looking at forming the Métis Nation of Ontario. And so I was pretty excited. It sounded like it was from somebody who knew what he was talking about.
The next year, it was the founding meeting to be held in Toronto. When we got there, my sister Lois, my brother Don, my brother George, Helen Bradley, who became a senator, Marion Larkman, who became a senator, and Marion's grandson. And we opened the doors and they just rushed in, and you never saw such a group of excited people. Finally, we're going to have proof that we're Métis, we're here, we've always been here, and there's nothing to do but just plow ahead.
And then in October of 93, I got a letter I was invited to be to participate in the founding delegates meeting in Toronto of the Métis Nation of Ontario. And that was pretty exciting, and I went. You had to sign up, and they made you a representative of an area. I went to the founding delegates assembly, May of 1994 in Toronto, and was proud to do so. It was pretty amazing. Yvonne Zimon was there. We all were presented with sashes. And very informative. We elected the new board of directors for the Métis Nation of Ontario. Tony Belcourt became president, of course. I knew that I wanted to be a part of it, even from the founding delegates assembly, because I could feel it from the people, the leaders. I could feel that they were going to move mountains for the Métis people of Ontario.
I think we grew quite quickly at that very first assembly we had here in Toronto, where our first meeting here. Maybe 50 people or something like that, but it grew incredibly. And I think a lot of that credit goes to the Rights Agenda, but I think a lot of the credit goes to Tony Belcourt himself, because he was a man of just unbelievable energy and drive.
You know, it was remarkably insightful for, you know, for the founders at the founding meeting to, in that statement of prime purpose, to develop that those visions that M&O needs to continue working towards. And again, certainly advancing Métis rights, you know, M&O's always been, you know, a high priority and a high focus on that aspect of it.
Once we had nailed down the fundamentals of what we wanted to put in the statement of prime purpose, then it was drafting time in terms of actually structuring the wording, and we crafted it, sent it back and forth to each other. And so it just came together, just the writing and the flowing of it just sort of coalesced after. It's fundamental whenever a government is established that there be a constitution setting out the rights of people, of the citizens. The statement of prime purpose is there.
All of that work, you know, was happening simultaneously while, you know, we were taking our fight to the courts, you know, the modern battlefield of that era and of today, where you're not getting anywhere with a government that refuses to negotiate with you, you're refusing to recognize Métis, refusing to recognize Métis rights. And so we took a strong determination that we had to advance that in the courts.
You know, one of the testaments of the M&O, when you connect it back to the statement of prime purpose, has always been we are focused on a rights-based agenda. So from the start, the M&O had tried to negotiate with Ontario to get a harvesting agreement, and there was a complete denial of Métis rights. In fact, there's that wonderful line from one of the letters that the minister of the day writes to the O'Connor family in Fort Frances of saying, we do not recognize the Métis have any special rights or interests in lands within Ontario. And so that really comes of, well, the battle needs to move to the courts. When you have absolutely no ability to move the yardstick politically, the courts is what we resort to in this country. And so I think that the promise of Section 35 to the Métis in 1982, we thought it would change. We thought that, okay, we finally got in the Constitution, our rights are recognized, governments will negotiate. And what we really recognized soon thereafter is that governments would only negotiate if you dragged them first to court and proved you had rights.
Basically what it was a guy who was hunting for food with his son and had made a decision that he was no longer going to hide. He'd been hiding his hunting all his life.
For years, like I said, since they found out they had the Métis rights, we had been bringing our moose home. We'd clean it right in the backyard, cut it up down the basement. It was all part of the family thing that we did. So the morning they went out and they brought the moose home, there was no problem till later on in the night. They'd brought it home, skinned it, cleaned it, you know, we're cutting it up. And because somebody had a beef with my son, they called the M&R and they said it was, you know, they'd been hunting illegally, they were shooting at night, and that was something we never did, because you hunt for your meat, you hunt for your food, you know, you harvest all your meat for the winter. It was never anything that was wasted or done like that. But because of what they said, M&R come into and charged him for hunting without a license.
Steve, quite a character. I enjoyed him. He was, he looked rough, he looked tough, but one of the nicest guys you'd ever meet in your life. You know, to take on a case that affected not only him, his son, Roddy, and Steve, but the whole Powley family, I think was a big challenge.
It was an enormous task to take on. We had no money. M&O was operating out of Tony's attic in Ottawa. And we did very well all the way up at trial. Every level of court, the judges were on side, and we just kept getting better and better and better decisions out of the courts until we got the ringing endorsement at the Supreme Court of Canada.
The big thing was that with the Supreme Court, it usually takes them 10 months, a year, 18 months, 2 years for that decision to come down. And when we heard that the decision was coming down, I think after 6 months, we knew we'd won.
Powley was a remarkable, to this day, it's a remarkable case in the sense that, you know, we ended up winning at every level. You know, right from the trial, you know, right through the Supreme Court of Canada, 14 judges have seen and heard the evidence, and we won at every level. It's a remarkable case in and of itself.
It was the first time, really, that anyone said, yes, Métis people are still here, and Métis people do exist, and Métis people have continued our way of life. To get that kind of recognition at the Supreme Court of Canada, like, what more could you ask for?
Mahatma Gandhi once said, it is your duty to break bad laws. And that's what Steve Powley broke that day. He broke a bad law, which the government were never gonna change without us fighting them to get our rights as Métis to hunt in Ontario.
I must say, I was never so proud of Steve Powley. When he said, the hell with it, I am going to be who I am, I'm going to hunt if I wanna. The Creator put that food there for me and I'll take it. And I'll let them know who I am. It was time that they realized that we are here as a nation of people and we do have to exist. And we don't exist on only air, we have to eat. And the Powley case was a real good one. And when we all stood behind him, made him a strong person, which will be, there'll be lots of Steve Powleys from now on that will say, well, if I need a piece of meat, I'm gonna go out and get one, and that's it. But not to waste. Steve did not waste anything that he had. He went and got that meat, he was gonna have it for the winter months. And I think it's a great thing.
When I would go to court for one of my harvesters as captain of the hunt, I would go to court with two things in my pocket, always, for the strength that I needed to do this. And one of the things was my father's harvesting card. He had passed away, so I have his harvesting card and I brought that with me. And Steve had given me a necklace. It was a dog tag with the infinity symbol on it, and he had given it to me after one of his wins. I remember where, we were at Tony Belcourt's house in Ottawa, and he had given it to me there. So I go to court with two things in my pocket, always. My father's harvesting card and Steve Powley's necklace. That's how much he means to me. That's how much he means to the Métis people.
I've done this for my children. Me and my youngest son here, Rod, we discussed this problem and we said, well, let's go for it. Now my granddaughter, I mean, at 3 years old, she was grabbing a knife, heading to the basement to cut a chunk off a moose we had down there. And that's what it's for, it's my children. Like I said, for me anymore, it's, you know, it's, I'm not looking for anything, I don't want anything, I just want my hunting rights for my family and myself. And as long as I'm in this earth, let me alone and me hunt where I should be hunting, where I live off the land. I mean, Métis, as far as I know my Métis family, we live off the land. We eat the meat off the land, so I did, but that's the reason I've done it, for my children and their children. You know, I didn't see the bigger picture for all Métis at the time, I won't lie to you. But after the second court case, I started to see the broader picture, and after this last one, it's just, like I said, it's just scary how many people it's actually going to help. So, and I'm glad if I can do it. You know?
We had a hard time getting capitalizing on Powley. We won, and then nothing changed. It was quite horrid, actually, and it took us a while to capitalize on that.
And this is one of the strategies government have used with Aboriginal peoples and the Métis specifically. Let's bust them apart by divide and conquer, and we'll, you know, deal with them as individuals, we don't see them as communities. And that is very hard to do when you are united in a solid one objective. And Powley was able to forge that, bringing communities from, you know, down south of Lake Huron to all the way up to Timmins, into Mattawa, is that we all knew that we were in the battle together.
But when we hit the Ontario Court of Appeal, again, we had wind in our sails. The judgments were coming out not only in our favor, but very strong wording out of the courts, particularly at the Ontario Court of Appeal. Really chastised the Ontario government for not dealing with Métis, and basically told them, you need to get some negotiations underway. And so that finally led us to the point where the Ontario government was kind of forced into setting up a negotiations table. And so there was after that we put together the rest of the negotiations team. We had a remarkable team.
2004, we had the AGA here in Thunder Bay at Chippewa Park. And the Minister of Natural Resources at the time, I believe he was, he wasn't in Toronto, he was somewhere else and all that, but they wound up having a, Tony and Gary, and then they wound up having a phone call with him some in one of the other buildings out at the Chippewa there.
We had a small room there that was piled full of boxes and the park's materials and so on. We could hardly move in there. And outside there was a big room, there was a big assembly hall filled with our people. It was the morning to be discussing what were we going to do for the fall hunt. We didn't have an agreement. And people were really upset.
Here's the, here's the lines we're at. Either we're going to have an agreement or we're not going to have an agreement. We put a lot of work into this, both sides, and it comes down to the crunch. And I've got, by the way, I've got an assembly room, right across the hall, waiting for an answer on this.
I got hold of David Ramsey, who was on a sailboat in Lake Huron. They were still giving us a bit of a hard time, but then finally, we got from the minister's chief of staff something that the minister had signed off on and approved. The terms of four-point agreement.
And when they come out, they announced that we have an agreement for our harvesting rights with the Ontario government, and the crowd just went nuts. It was a great moment for everybody there.
Ladies and gentlemen, members of the media and our citizens, this morning, just a very short while ago, in a conversation that we have had and I had with the Minister of Natural Resources from the Government of Ontario, we now have confirmation that after 132 years of discrimination, racial prejudice, a denial of the very existence of the Métis people in the province of Ontario, ever since the days of the bounty of $5,000 passed on the legislature in Ontario on the head of Louis Riel. We now have a government of Ontario that has made the commitment that it is going to respect and recognize the rights of the Métis Nation in this province.
But it was so electrified, that room, in the sense that people were, if we wouldn't have got an agreement, it was wonderful to have the solidarity of our people behind us. That whole room was in solidarity that, we will do something because we've been patient through the courts, we've been patient for a 10-year battle, we've done things properly, responsibly through a negotiated process, and we deserve a negotiated, we deserve to have our rights recognized, and we deserve a negotiated agreement.
And so I think that 2004 agreement, people don't understand how much it made a difference in people's lives. They didn't have to go out, as the court says in Powley, skulking through the bush like common criminals. They were able to go out and hunt with their children and have a level of pride and respect for themselves as well as for who they were as people, and not have to worry with about the Ministry of Natural Resources nabbing them on the way home.
Finally signed an agreement, I think it was 2004, at the annual assembly. We more or less staged a demand on the government. We had all kinds of people all lined up. We were going to go into big protest mode if they didn't actually implement or sign an agreement with us. And they signed the last minute we got one, and then they promptly broke it. So they were still charging people. We had a whole bunch of outstanding charges. They proceeded to drop them all over the next course of the next few months. December 12th was the last day that they dropped the last charge, and that same day they started charging again. So we had to take them back to court again. And that was the Lorraine case, which we won again in 2007. And the trial judge was quite angry, and he wrote a blistering judgment against Ontario for what they had been doing. And I think that was the turning point.
So I think after 2007 and the Lorraine decision, the tide really changed. And so what we've really been doing since 2007, 2008, is that we've been out of the era of fighting at each other's throats and in an era of how can we work together?
I think without question, you know, another one of the significant milestones we reached was November 17th, 2008, when we signed the frame agreement with the province of Ontario. And for me, that was a monumental shift. You know, Ontario is, historically, going back, as Canada was being developed as a country, was very hostile towards Métis people. And, you know, even right through Powley, you know, denied the existence of Métis people. We don't exist, we don't have communities. It was not a good relationship here in Ontario with Métis people. But in 2008, November 17th specifically, we signed a frame agreement. You know, that frame agreement represents a shift in attitude in the way we're going to be doing things with Ontario. It took us, in my view, from an era of denial that Métis exist or deny that we have any rights, into an era towards reconciliation, where we're mutually agreed to work on a number of issues that are important to both the province of Ontario and the Métis Nation of Ontario. We've really seen a major shift here in Ontario with the things we've been able to work with the Ontario government at, where we see mutual benefit. You know, these things are, they're certainly benefiting Métis citizens in a big way, but they're also benefiting the province. People are getting the skills they need to go to work. Métis people are having the opportunities to create businesses, to create jobs, and that's a win-win for the Métis people, and it's a win for Ontario.
Mr. Speaker, we move that this House commemorates 2010 as the year of the Métis, and that the Ontario Legislature recognizes and honors the distinct culture, identity, and heritage of the Métis people in the province, as well as the historic and ongoing contributions of the Métis in Ontario.
Imagine this, you know, 125 years ago, prior to this, it was Ontario government that sent the troops out to fight against the Métis in Batoche. Here we have a minister and a government standing up in the House, you know, recognizing 2010 as the year of the Métis. Used the Métis Nation, and reading a proclamation. Minister Bentley at the time, you know, speaking some Machif in his presentation to the House, and acknowledging the contributions the Métis people have given to the province and are continuing to contribute to the province and country today.
It is my pleasure to rise in the House today on this very important and unique occasion where we recognize the unique history, culture, and people who are the Métis. And I would like to say at the outset, bonjour Tanchi, bienvenue à tous, merci d'être.
Welcome to everyone and thank you for being here.
Machif, that's Machif for hello and welcome.
You know, if we're moving towards that era of proper recognition, respect, and reconciliation, you know, those are high marks. You know, you can't give a government any higher marks than taking that route and showing that respect. So I commend the Ontario government on a number of fronts.
I've been with the MNO since about 1996 and have seen incredible growth. Amazing things happen, and really that's really a short time. Even though it seems like a long time, sometimes for me, it's relatively short in terms of an organization development. And we've seen so many things grow in terms of staffing. We've seen the actual investments that we've been able to secure through government partners, industry partners, grow immensely. And I think that's due to the fact that we've put down stronger policies, we've laid that foundation again, we've really got more people engaged and interested in the organization. And so from that, you see really healthy, positive structures put in place, policies put in place, and some new priorities that have been able to be expanded and enhanced to really help communities, which is really what it's all about, and get the citizenship more involved in the MNO.
An AGA, first of all, stands for Annual General Assembly. And it's the one time of the year that we bring our people together. We usually bring our presidents of our communities. We bring our senators of our communities. And the reason we do it is to make sure that every community has representation and has a say in the AGA. Because the AGA is actually the place where the mandates for the coming year are set, the priorities are set, because that's the true governance of the nation. We are bound to do what is decided at the AGA, but it's crucial for many reasons. First of all, it's crucial for the business, but it's also crucial for the family atmosphere that we have in Métis Nation of Ontario. Up to about 5 years ago, we used to have them in big parks under a tent, come rain or shine or lightning. I mean, one of our AGAs in Thunder Bay, our tent was hit by lightning, one of the tent poles. So we've had a lot of experience, but we've always lived that experience as a family, and it brings people that see themselves only once a year, see each other once a year, and they're just like the best of friends, you know. And so it's very important to hold the MNO together.
But it's also a place for you to reconnect with old friends that are across the province that you never get to see. You know, those are young, old, community council citizens. Sometimes it's just community people in the local area where we have the AGA, wherever it's taking place, and they're walking in, such as someone like yourself, and they're, oh, well, what's this about? And I don't know that I've ever heard anyone say, I didn't feel welcome when they attended an AGA.
Again, every year there's highlights, and every year the community gets to celebrate, and it's really nice that we have it moving around to all those different communities every year, because you learn a little bit more about those communities and their history. So I think that's an important part of moving those AGAs. And again, it's who we are, and it's that key to moving the business of the MNO forward.
Well, every AGA is different, and every AGA is a wonderful event to attend, because that's where you meet your second family. And you know, you have 4 or 5 days of remembering and getting together. It's unbelievable. I've had people at the AGA saying, you know, Cam, if you ever go through my town, you know, don't get a hotel room, come and say, you know, stay at my place. And you know, I offer the same thing back, you know, if you're ever going through Thunder Bay. So that's the type of people that you run into and become friends, right?
I think it's the people and that sense of family, that it really is a sense of family. and just thinking about, you know, the future and what our job is going to be in the future is to do what the adults are doing, the older people are doing, and to learn from them so that we're prepared for when, you know, our time comes.
I look forward to the AGAs every year. It's like a big family gathering. I've met so many wonderful people. I look forward to some of the special times with some of the senators.
My fonder memories for an AGA certainly was in Thunder Bay quite a few years ago, but me and my mother being up late at night with all the other people around, we had a huge fire, picnic tables all around, Glenn Lipinski I know playing his guitar, and everybody else playing guitars and singing and everything like that. And I know I had been doing a smoked fish workshop there during the day, and obviously had a lot of fish left over. And so we fried it up just in the middle of the night, impromptu kind of fish fry, and so that was really fun. And
but I remember that one AGA there, a thunderstorm came along and heavy winds, and it just rained, and the water was running through the tent, and it was just, it was neat, because where we were in the Fort William First Nation territory, kind of, and it's Chippewa Park, and right behind Chippewa Park is a mountain they call Mountain McKay. And that's called the Thunder Mountain. And boy, did it ever produce that day. There was thunder and lightning going on, and it was wild for a while there. But the rain that came down, oh my God. If we wouldn't have had that tent, we'd have been all drowned. it was exciting.
Another big area of involvement for youth is in the cultural activities and getting involved in, as I said, picking up those things that were nearly lost through the generations, and connecting with our elders, and connecting with our senators, and connecting with our veterans, right, and picking up and listening to those stories. So I think there's kind of a duality of roles with the business of the nation as well as the heritage and the culture of the nation. I think and I think those two go hand in hand. I think we can't have one without the other. If we're going to be a strong, healthy nation, we need both. We need the culture, we need our heritage, we need our spirituality, but we need to be prepared to deal with whatever comes at us.
I think telling these stories about how the MNO first started and the development of the organization is critical to really giving people a sense of why they're involved and maintaining those connections beyond just the everyday business of, you know, contribution agreements and getting the work done and doing it in the best possible way and the most accountable way, but making sure that we still know why there's a Métis Nation of Ontario, and it's because we're Métis people. We have distinct rights and we need to be recognized, and we need to treasure and honor that past and that history and that vibrant culture that continues to exist in communities all across Ontario.
Our staff are a different breed of people, I'd say, even, because you know what? They just give and give. You go to community meetings, you go to community feasts, the staff are there. A lot of them could get better jobs somewhere else, less stress, less hours, more pay. But they stay, and a lot of them stay because they're so dedicated to the Métis Nation.
Every single day, I'm absolutely amazed at the caliber of staff that we have, the work they do, the overtime that they put in, the passion they have for the Métis and the work that we're doing. And also, even more importantly, are the communities. I just cannot believe how much work is done by the people in the communities. We have a little over 16,000 folks registered in the Métis Nation of Ontario now over the age of 16. And of those 16,000, there's actually only 4 political people that are remunerated in any way, shape, or form, which by my calculation means that there's somewhere in the order of 15,996 volunteers who, since the beginning, are what has made the MNO what it is.
Many of us, like myself, have grown up in, right? We've grown up in the MNO, and we've come to really appreciate all that has been done for us and for future generations by the leadership and by the everyone, right? From community council right to the provincial council.
Key things that I have seen over the years is the advancement of the PCMNO, the quality of the leadership. But as Secretary Treasurer, I'm very proud of the fact that we've taken care and control of our finances. And I think that has really enabled the MNO to grow immensely over the last number of years.
The captains of the hunt who kind of, you know, manage the hunt and look at issues that are important to that, certainly on the harvesting side, but also what's going on out in the territories and keeping their pulse on that. and play a very important, effective role on that whole harvesting side of it.
So I've been a captain of the hunt from the beginning for Georgian Bay, Region 7, have thoroughly enjoyed it. So what the captains do is, well, several things. We assisted in forming the policy, the harvesting policy, within the Métis Nation of Ontario, with, of course, legal counsel and the provisional counsel of the Métis Nation of Ontario. So we implement the policy with our harvesters. They apply for their harvester's certificates through the captains of the hunt. We take their questions, field their questions. We bring input that they may have to the captain of the hunt meetings for the captains to discuss, and we make recommendations to the PCMNO if changes are required to the policy.
The WSMNO is a committee within the Métis Nation of Ontario. We represent the women in Ontario. We work on their behalf. It's important for some of the women don't feel that they are leaders, and they need to realize that when you're a leader in your family, you're a leader in your community. We need to encourage those women. When we talk about for our children be the best they can be, I think many of them are in the same position that I was. I didn't know I was Métis. I didn't find out till I was 39 years old. So when you think about that, and many of us were suppressed, so I can remember one of our events that we had for leadership training, our very first one that we had in Toronto, and there was one of the women that were there, and she couldn't even lift up her head and even speak. She was so shy and timid and afraid to speak in public. And at the end of the leadership training, she was smiling, looking up at us. And to see a transformation like that, that was just amazing.
The veterans, certainly in the past few years, we've seen the veterans come together in a very positive way, and getting the rightful recognition that they so deserve. You know, Métis veterans have been extremely, put it this way, we're all proud of Métis veterans. You know, they've been in every major conflict that Canada's been involved in, you know, something that's truly, you know, remarkable within our own communities and our own nation ourselves. So having them being able to bring that into the Métis Nation's voice, to give proper recognition and respect for their past accomplishments, but those accomplishments that are continuing today as they continue to serve in conflicts that are continuing to happen.
We have a great council. We work very, very well together. And basically we advocate for our veterans to help showcase our veterans and to help put them on the map.
Within the Métis Nation of Ontario, we have, you know, the senators who are, you know, a part of our provincial government, PCMNO, and they're part of every community council, and they get together and have their own discussions. So the senators are, you know, often a voice of reasons, or you know, that calming part, but they also certainly bring, you know, good positive discussion, and certainly their historical perspective and a wealth of knowledge that they've accumulated over the lifetime into that discussion.
Senators is another word for Métis elders, right? And they do hard work.
The old senators are there as elders, like as guides. You don't have to be old to be an elder. You just have to be able to guide or explain things. And tomorrow I'm going to a school, and that's our greatest thing, is when we go to schools. When you're in the schools explaining things, I always start off with telling them, I am not First Nation, I am not Inuit, and I'm not a European. I am a true Canadian and Métis.
We've got the Youth Council. Certainly, you know, we talked about the importance of youth. You know, they're knowing and understanding the issues and being fully involved and fully engaged on what's going on in MNO. And as we say, they're the ones that will carry the torch. And so having them actively involved at our AGAs, learning the skill sets that they do as being part of the Youth Council, so eventually they'll be able to step into the provincial council role and know how to function as a board, a council, and work together is extremely important.
Certainly the last few years, youth have been getting very involved in the politics of the MNO. We've had the special business resolution section of the General Assembly has for the last 2 years had more resolutions coming from the Youth Council than from any other sector of the MNO. I think youth are getting very involved politically, both in setting the direction of the MNO internally and setting direction for the MNO's relations with other Aboriginal groups and with mainstream Ontarians.
MNO is part of a long history and narrative of Ontario Métis asserting themselves as a part of the larger Métis Nation. And I think what's interesting is we each have carried the torch a little bit. So whether it's the organizations of the past, the leaders of the past, have never just completely rolled over or never accepted. Well, we have gone underground in some dark periods. That culture, that identity, that history has never died. And each generation, I think we get the chance of rekindling it even more. And I've, been happy to be a part of the MNO over the last 20 years, I think really adding an important additional chapter to that history in Ontario that flows through the waterways and around the Great Lakes of Ontario into the prairies.
Looking and reflecting back on 20 years of remarkable growth and coming together here in Ontario, to bring the MNO, the Métis Nation of Ontario, from that original vision, that original dream, to where we are today. And again, remembering that even though we're celebrating particularly these 20 years, these two decades, it's really just a continuation of a struggle that's been going on for, two centuries.
I'd like to see the youth that were helped by the Métis Nation to continue and stay with them and get more people recognize that they are Métis, because more people are looking for their roots, where before a lot of people didn't even talk about it.
It's important to connect with your culture, because you can't know where you're going in the future if you don't know where you've come from in the past.
My greatest dream is to see our youth succeed. And then they can further the nation. Then it's their turn. But in the meantime, they are working towards that goal. And I'm very proud of them.
So as a person sort of in the sunset of life who's experiencing their traditions for the first time, it really, really means a lot to participate in this and to see all the great things that have happened since 1993.
It's kind of a stew that's been cooking and getting more flavors and evolving as we go along. And wow, 20 years later, it's getting to be a pretty good stew, I think.
But and I think as young people, I think we're really starting to look at the MNO as somewhere where we have grown up and want our kids to grow up, right? Some young people now, some youth are starting their own families, and they're thinking about wanting their kids to be involved in the MNO and seeing the MNO as somewhere where they can they can work and start a career, and they could or they could be involved politically or all these different things. I think that the MNO is really becoming a home.
It's remarkable to be here at this time, and also to know with 100% certainty that going into the future, our future is very bright. When I look and talk to and meet the youth of today and the people that are out there in our communities actively engaging themselves in any infinite number of discussions, whether it's in duty to consult on and accommodate discussions, whether it's in advancing education, whether it's working to improve the health conditions of Métis people and families across the province, or housing, just doing everything we can do in so many arenas to help our people. In talking to the young people who are getting the skill sets we could only dream of in the past, all ranks of professions and into the business world, taking the rightful place in society, I can say with 100% certainty, the future of the Métis Nation here in Ontario is very bright. And I think, I want to pay tribute to all of the people that are with us here today, but all of the people that are not with us here today as well. We've certainly lost many of the people that championed and held the torch, the mantle for a while we were building the MNO over the past 20 years have fallen. They've moved on into the afterworld, and we think of them so often. They're with us, they're with us here now, and they're certainly with us in many other instances. You know, those people helped in a great, meaningful way to build what we have. You know, that's something I hope our youth take forward is, you know, everything we're doing is for you to go forward. We want to build M&O to be the strongest and the best it can be going forward, but it's your responsibility to take it going forward.
Because this is a very, this is a, as we say, it's a nation of people that were never allowed to spread their wings. We were boxed in like that into a cocoon and never allowed to spread our wings and say, here, look, we are people. We are a nation of people, proud nation of people. We are. We stay together. We help each other. Thank you.